Hello everyone all around the world. Welcome to my workshop, mini workshop on retrospecting your retrospectives. And in this workshop we're going to explore when retrospectives fail and what causes them to fail. So we're going to dive into retrospectives. We're going to take a look on what are the factors that influence good retrospectives and what happens when things go wrong, when things fail, and how can we learn from that and how can we debug our retrospectives to turn them into something good, to keep them valuable. This is going to be a virtual workshop, which may be a bit strange at first, but I'll try to make it as interesting, as interactive as possible, given the circumstances that we are in right now. In the coming hour, I'm going to talk a lot about retrospectives, about what makes retrospective fails, but I'm also going to do a lot of demonstrations. I'm going to show you how you can actually debug your retrospectives, how you can dive into the retrospective ritual, find out what's going wrong, correct that, and improve your retrospectives. So bear with me. After this hour, we're going to have half an hour Q&A. So if you have any questions along the way, make a note, jot them down, and we're going to go into those questions. Retrospectives are a great thing. Retrospectives are a great practice because they help teams to learn and to improve. So they help teams to find out how they are doing. They help people to learn from how they are doing their work, people to explore how they are collaborating, how they are communicating with each other, how they manage to deliver stuff, how they sometimes don't manage to deliver stuff. So I think retrospectives are a great thing, given that they help teams to improve. I've been doing sessions for teams, for projects to improve for more than 30 years. In earlier days, those sessions were called lessons learned sessions, post-mortem sessions, where you dived into a problem, where you tried to learn from that problem. And I learned about retrospectives, first project retrospectives in 2001 from the book by Norm Kurt, and later Agile Retrospectives, the book from Esther Derby and Diana Larson. And a lot of stuff in there really resonated with me because I was doing these kind of lessons learned sessions as a facilitator. I was helping teams to learn. I was helping teams to dive deeply into how they were doing the work. And I was helping teams to find the things that they would like to improve. I was not imposing any stuff on them. I was helping them to find out where they would like to put their energy and what they would like to do differently. And this is what I clearly saw in the retrospectives as a main theme in there. So I think retrospectives are a great thing. So retrospectives are great. Well, except when they are not. And that happens, unfortunately. Retrospectives fail sometimes. Sometimes things go wrong in your retrospectives. And when they fail, they usually fail big time. I've seen this happen over and over again. They fail because they're not leading to any improvement. It's the same stuff coming back over and over again. It's people getting bored in the retrospectives. It's a retrospective turning into a blaming session. All this kind of stuff happens in retrospectives, unfortunately. And this is something that we really need to work on. This is something that I don't think it's necessary. You can prevent most of this stuff. And when this happens as a facilitator, you can and you should deal with this. And that's what we're going to explore in this mini workshop. So let's look at some of the problems that can happen in retrospectives. Things that I see happening when I facilitate retrospectives or when I train or coach people on doing retrospectives. And some of the things that's happening in there is that you see retrospectives where the same actions are coming up over and over again. And people are actually saying that in the retrospective. Like we mentioned this before, we came up with this stuff already in the previous retrospective and the one before, and we're still having the same problem. The problem is not being solved. And that's something that you don't want to happen. You want to make progress in your retrospective. Even if it's just small steps, small improvement, you want to make sure that things get better after your retrospective. The retrospectives can be boring, and the main reason why I see that retrospectives become boring is that they're being done in the same format every time, every retrospective again. And usually that's the format which relates back to the Scrum Guide. Like you're just using sticky notes and asking a few questions like, okay, what went wrong? What can we improve? And just focusing on those questions and trying to hammer that in with the people and trying to use that to find improvements. It doesn't work. It might work initially. It might work in your first or second retrospective if you use those questions. But if you really want to get benefit out of your retrospectives, use different kind of format, use different kind of exercises in your retrospective to really get improvements out of your meeting. There could be an elephant in the room. There could be a problem that nobody wants to talk about. Everybody knows about it, but it's there and it's actually blocking people because they're talking about other stuff, but they're not addressing the real issue. And when this happens, then people will leave the retrospective feeling unsatisfied. Like, yeah, we spoke for about an hour, but no, the big issue is still there. We didn't talk about it. And I think this is something where a retrospective facilitator should help the team to bring it out, to bring the issue out, and to help them to talk about it. How difficult it can be, but it's an important issue, and you need to deal with that. If retrospective fails, what you see happening often is that people start skipping them. And I've seen a lot of Scrum Masters and Agile coaches complaining about this. Like, okay, my people are skipping the retrospective and I'm making them mandatory and I'm telling them over and over again that they need to be in the retrospective. They need to be there. They need to join it. If people are skipping the retrospective, there's probably a reason for that. And you have to find out that reason. And the best way to find out that reason is to talk with them or to do a retrospective on your retrospective, which is actually one of the techniques that we're going to dive into deeper. You want to know why they're skipping the retrospective. What's the reason? Because then you can address the real problem. It's not the behavior that's wrong. The behavior is probably right because the retrospectives are not beneficial for them. And if a meeting is not beneficial, what do? You try to skip them. Makes sense, right? So people are right if they want to skip the retrospective. I've also seen retrospective where there was a kind of predefined agenda in there. It was leading in a certain direction, it was leading to certain actions, certain improvements in there. And even if that wasn't really intentional, if people feel like this in the retrospective, your meeting is not going to work. People have some idea and they're like, okay, we're just going through the ceremonies, but we know the outcome. We know what's going to be the result of this meeting. They're not going to be fully open. They're not going to be participating. They don't believe in that meeting. So summing up, these are the kind of problems that can happen in your retrospective. These are things that can make your retrospective fail. And when these kind of problems happen, we need to do something about them. So what can we do if we would like to improve the quality of our retrospectives, if we want to find out where they are failing and want to improve them? Well, I compare this a little bit with failure of code. If your code fails, if your code contains an error, you want to find that error, you want to find that bug. So my suggestion would actually be to start debugging your retrospectives. Find out what's happening in there, find out what is causing them to fail, and then address this. And I think this is primarily a responsibility for the retrospective facilitator, for the one who's organizing the meeting, the one who is leading the meeting, sharing the meeting, and doing the actual retrospective. And this might be your Scrum Master, this might be an Agile coach, this might be the Scrum Master of another team, but somebody will have the role in the retrospective of facilitating that meeting. And I think that's the person who's primarily there to lead this retrospective to a good result, and is also the person to find out where the retrospective is failing to improve it. But to find out, to explore where the retrospective is failing, to learn from this, that person can use help from the team. It's a collaborative activity. It's working together to find out how we can improve it. I listed a couple of exercises, techniques here that you can use to debug your retrospective. And these are suggestions. These are not recipes. These are not something like, okay, if I do this kind of technique, then my retrospectives will be perfect. What I'm hoping is with these five different exercise in there. I'm hoping to inspire you, to give you some ideas on how to do it. You can pull out one or two, try them in your teams, your organization, how to work out. You can also improvise, think about one of these techniques, but do it differently in your organization. You can come up with something completely differently, maybe compared to how you're debugging software, something that works in there, and then you can translate to retrospective. So, but whatever you do, if there's something going wrong in retrospective, make sure that you dive into it and find out. So a quick overview of these techniques. Agile Retrospective Bingo is a kind of fun game. You could compare it a little bit with something that's called the bullshit bingo, where people are tagging behavior or tagging words that people are using in a meeting that's not really working well. Well, this is the same thing, but then for retrospectives. So it's a way to visualize unproductive behavior in your retrospective. And once you've visualized it, you can work on that and you can find out ways to improve it. And there's actually game settings surrounding this where you can do it with a role play, driving this behavior and experiment as retrospective facilitator to work on this. You can do a retrospective on your retrospective. So what you're actually doing is using retrospective exercises, retrospective techniques to explore, to reflect on the way how you are doing retrospectives and to learn from that. So you're making the retrospective the topic of your retrospective. And this may sound a little bit strange to people, like, okay, the retrospective is supposed to be on what we did in the last sprint or the last 2 weeks, right? Not completely. Basically, you can do retrospectives on anything that's important for you. And for most of the team, it's what they're doing right now, and that's what happened in the past 2 weeks or in the past sprint. But if your retrospectives are failing, let's do a retrospective on your retrospective. Let's find out why they're failing. You can use the retrospective smells cards, and they come together with antidotes. Retrospective smells are an indicator that something is going wrong with your retrospective. People sometimes also call them retrospective anti-patterns. I see like the smell is your first indicator, like a code smell, like, okay, there's something here in this code that doesn't look well. There's some pattern in here that I recognize where I think that might not be working. And then the result of that will be the behavior in your retrospective. So once you really smell it and then start smelling more, that's when the failure of your retrospective becomes visible. The retrospective smell is something that you want to smell as early as possible, as soon as possible, to address it before you go into big problems. And once you recognize the smell, then you're thinking about, okay, how can I address it? How can I address the problems that are happening in my retrospective right now? And to do that, I'm providing lists of antidotes that might help in this situation when this smell is happening. Again, these are not recipes. These antidotes are tips, ideas, suggestions that you can use in there that might help you to find out what's in there, that might help you to even dig deeper, to ask some additional questions, to explore the situation, and then you can use them to improve in there. Improving your retrospective facilitation means really looking at how you are facilitating this meeting. And these are some ideas, some tips on what makes retrospective facilitation successful. What's the important thing that facilitators should be aware of, should learn, should practice to really lead that retrospective meeting and to lead it up to good results in there. Then the final technique, assessing your retrospective, assessing the strengths and weaknesses in there. And this goes back to a kind of self-assessment that are becoming more and more popular in Agile assessments that teams can do themselves to see how they are performing, where teams can explore to see where they are on their Agile journey. And you can use these same kind of techniques in there, same kind of games, also to work on your retrospectives, to measure the health of your retrospectives and to use that to improve them. Okay, so this, again, 5 different techniques that you can use to debug your retrospectives. And we're going to be exploring them in more detail right now. The Agile Retrospective Bingo is a game that you can play in your team. It's a game that you can do in the retrospective or in a separate meeting, or as a kind of training session if you want to practice your retrospective skills and you want to learn about that. The basic thing of this game are, as I retrospective, bingo cards, and these are bingo cards that list unproductive behavior, things that you prefer not to see in your retrospective that can hamper the outcome of your retrospective. And there's lots of different retrospective cards there. They all have the same terms, but different bingo cards so that you can play a kind of bingo game with different people in your retrospective and see who comes up with bingo first. That's the gamification aspect of this thing. And there's also role cards that come with this. This is something that you can play on site with teams using physical cards, using the physical role cards and something like fishes that you can put on the card to see what kind of behavior is happening. But you can also play it remotely by using an online whiteboard and using images of the cards and images of the role play to play with this. The Agile Retrospective Bingo is an agile coaching tool. It's a serious game that you can use to improve your retrospectives. It starts with bingo cards. Here's an example of one of them, which contains words of behavior that you can see in your retrospective. And this card helps you to recognize this behavior and as a retrospective facilitator act on that. If you want to go one step further, there's also a game you can play with this using different kind of behavior cards, and these cards will help people to play a role in a retrospective and to see how this works out to improve your retrospective facilitation skills. How can you use the Agile Retrospective Bingo cards to improve your retrospective? Start by handing out a couple of these cards to people attending the retrospective. And their role will be to be observer. So they will be observing what's happening in the retrospective. And if they see some kind of behavior that's mentioned on the card, they will put a coin on that behavior. And once they get a row on the bingo card, they will shout out, "Bingo!" That's basically, so it's a kind of fun game, but it's also a game which helps you to recognize unproductive behavior in your retrospective and help to practice your skills to deal with this. The Agile Retrospective Bingo can be played in co-located teams, but also in distributed teams. When you download the games, you get PDF files with the cards, with the bingo cards and the role cards that you use in the game. But you also get JPEG pictures of all the cards so that you can also distribute them and use them on online boards and play the game with a distributed team online, whatever works for you. What is unproductive behavior? Unproductive behavior is anything that happens in the retrospective that is not helping the retrospective to reach its goal. It could be blaming, it could be people complaining about stuff, it could be people who are looking outside the room, not being involved in the retrospective. So there's many different kinds of unproductive behavior which is there. And the goal of the Agile Retrospective Bingo game is to recognize this behavior and to deal with this. So let me give an example. Let me share my screen so that you can see what's on the bingo card. So, what's the kind of behavior that might happen in your retrospective? Well, it might be somebody who's putting a blame on management, putting the source of the problem outside the meeting. That's not going to help you to solve any problems if everybody's always complaining that it's management that's making it impossible for them to do their job. It could be somebody who's not speaking up. Maybe they're afraid to speak, or they don't know how to say stuff in there, or they don't feel comfortable enough to say something. It could be somebody who's continuously interrupting the speaker. So if somebody tries to say something, then somebody else jumps in. That's not going to be really productive if that's happening a lot. Shouting, finger pointing, somebody acting selfish. There's so many different behaviors in there. And these Agile Retrospective Bingo cards collected all these kinds of unproductive behavior, and creates a game around it to recognize it and to deal with it. The Agile Retrospective Bingo can also be used to train your retrospective facilitation skills. This is all about recognizing unproductive behavior and finding ways to deal with this. If you want to use it in this way, then you will use the Agile Retrospective Bingo card, but you will also use the role play cards to play a game with this bingo. And let me show how that works. So people have the bingo card with all this unproductive behavior on this, and you will hand out the cards for the role play to people who are participating in retrospective. So for instance, one person will be the facilitator, leading the meeting, helping people to explain themselves, helping people to come up with their thoughts. There's other role play cards you can hand out. So for instance, a card which describes a talk a lot role. This is somebody who's talking a lot, doing a lot of stuff, mentioning stuff, maybe interrupting people in there, making jokes. But if it comes to a point that you want to do something, you want to decide, this person doesn't really feel comfortable with that, so we'll start a new discussion in there. Another card would be somebody who's playing the silent introvert. And this person doesn't feel safe enough, feels a bit shy, doesn't really want to speak up in the retrospective. And they may have good ideas, by the way, but those ideas don't come up in the retrospective because this person is a bit afraid to tell them. Another card, and don't tell me you never saw this in the retrospective. Not my fault. This is a role with somebody who's complaining in the retrospective. Yes, there's lots of problems in this team, but there's nothing that I can do about it. It's not my fault. I'm doing my work. I'm doing everything right. It's other people who are making mistakes. And this is why all of this kind of stuff is happening. So you hand out these cards to the people in the retrospective. They start playing this role, and the facilitator starts facilitating this retrospective and see what's happening in there. And then, of course, these behaviors mentioned on the bingo card, they will pop up for sure because they are related to the roles that we have in there. The silent introvert will be somebody who's not speaking up in there, where the talk a lot will be interrupting people all of the time. So these cards will help to enable this behavior, to make sure that this behavioral surface in the retrospective, and then the facilitator can practice how to deal with this, and the whole team can reflect as a group to see how they deal with this kind of behavior in the retrospective and learn from that. One of the great things of the Agile Retrospectives Bingo is that you can actually play it with remote teams quite easily. So let's go back to the setup that we had with the team when they were playing it remotely. So assuming that there's a couple of people in your team that are doing the role play in there, there's a facilitator, there's somebody playing the role, not my fault, somebody talk a lot, there's a silent introvert in there, and there's a couple of people who are observing what's happening in the retrospective. So if they see some kind of behavior in there that's mentioned on the card, they can pick a coin and put it on the card. And you can actually work with different colors of coins so that everybody can put their own cards in it. You can choose to give everybody their own card, but you can also share a card and work together on this, making it a collaborative game. So, for instance, if this purple person sees that the introvert is silent and was feeling unsafe, he might pick a coin and look at, okay, where is it? Yeah. Put it on feeling unsafe. If the red observer is looking and seeing that, okay, there's a lot of interruption in the speaker by talk a lot, put it over there. If the talk a lot person is also acting from the selfish or egoistic, or maybe this person, not my fault, is saying like, okay, I can't do anything about it, put one over there. And it's been a while since the silent introvert spoke up, so, okay, he's not speaking up, he's being silent. So if one of the person even start joking, well, that's when we get into a bingo. So, you can make it a collaborative game, you can everybody give their own card, but you can also work together on one retrospective bingo card. Work together as a team to make your retrospectives better. If you want to become a better retrospective facilitator, download the Agile Retrospective Bingos from www.benlinders.com. Latest game in your retrospective. Practice a skill. Practice with all the different kind of behaviors that are happening in your retrospective. Find ways to become a better facilitator. A retrospective on retrospectives. Okay, how would something like that work? Well, you're doing a retrospective, but you're making the way that retrospectives are going in your team, in your project, the topic of your retrospective. So you're going to be focusing on the way that retrospectives are being done. You're going to dive deeply into the retrospective meetings, the actions coming out of this, follow up with your day in the organization on these actions, getting these actions done, everything that's surrounding retrospectives and that is looking at how to do continuous improvement with your retrospectives. And to do this, you can use different exercises, different techniques to do your retrospective. Here's a couple of examples of exercises you can use. So let's take the first one, the car brand. The car brand exercise is described in my book, Getting Value Out of Agile Retrospectives. And basically, this exercise works by asking the team to compare how we are doing retrospectives right now to a car brand. So do some kind of association. If your retrospectives were a car brand, how would you call them? And when people have done that association, describe why, you can ask them a second question and say, okay, what car would we like it to be? What kind of car brand, car mark would we like our retrospective view? Where would we like to be heading in there? So let me give an example. Say that your retrospectives have a lot of ceremony in there, a lot of stuff surrounding it, and people feel like, okay, you're overloading us with process. You're putting much too much stuff in there before we actually get to the discussions and to the improvements. So it's a much too heavy meeting for us. We want to have something lightweight in there. We want to have something where we can experiment, where we can go much more quickly. And somebody might say like, okay, our retrospectives look like a Hummer. So yeah, well, they're rock solid because after a 1.5 hour or 2 hour, yeah, we get to some improvements. There's some stuff coming out of the retrospective. But the way we get there, my God, it's taking a lot of energy. It's boring at times. And we should be having a different way to do this. There should be a way to be much more effective on this, much more focused, much more quicker and getting some improvements out of there. And I'm having a hard time staying focused within the retrospective needs by the way they are being run. So how would we like our retrospective meetings to be? Well, maybe we could turn them into something like a Volkswagen. Say, they're still solid, they're still reliable, it's still like a good thing that we're doing in there, but a little bit less ceremony, a little bit less formal, but still we want to keep the good stuff in there because we have actions coming out of it, we see improvements ongoing in the organization, so we want to keep that. But what can we do to reduce ceremony and keep the strengths in our retrospective? So this is a kind of example how you can use the car brand, and different people will come up with different car, different brand. And it's not that much about the car or the brand. It's about the motivation. It's about the reason behind why they associated with that car, with that brand. That's what makes it interesting. It's the discussion that is triggered through this metaphor of cars. That's what helps you to improve your retrospective. So another technique, and that's just actually a very lightweight one, would be a one-word retrospective on your retrospective, where the question would be, if you could describe our retrospective using one word, what would that word be? And again, people will probably come up with different words, and at first I just ask them to state the word. Write it down, shout it out loud, put it on the whiteboard, whatever works. But don't discuss it, just put down the word. And I want to see these words together. I want to see the whole picture and the different opinions there. And then we can start discussing those words to see, okay, why do you feel about your retrospective like this? And feeling is the important thing in it, because the one word exercise typically tends to bring out how people feel about stuff. Tends to bring out the deeper thoughts on retrospectives. And that's the kind of stuff that's usually hard to get out in a retrospective. It's something that people are not always eager to talk about. And using the one word is a very lightweight way to bring it out. If your retrospective sucks, probably somebody is going to say it. And they might not say it if you do a sticky note retrospective, what went well or what could be improved. But if they really suck, if you're lucky, one of the person will say they suck. Okay, why? What? Why do you feel they suck? So this is something that really helps you to get to the deep thoughts, the deep ideas behind why retrospectives are working or not working in there. So this is two examples. Again, there are a lot of retrospective exercises that you can use. There's a full list of retrospective exercises on my website, benlinders.com/exercises. So you can pick exercise over there. There's lots of books about it. Pick one that you as a facilitator feel familiar with. Pick an exercise that you think will resonate with the team. Set the topic on retrospectives and start exploring how your retrospectives are going. Retrospective smells go back to that something is going wrong in your retrospectives, and you as a facilitator are smelling this. The things in the retrospective that are giving you the idea, giving you the impression that there might be a problem. And you don't know for sure. Everything might be well, but I think it's always important as a retrospective facilitator to be aware of that, to reach out and to see if something's happening, if things are going right in your perspective. And in case of doubt, dive into it. Let's explore and see what the smell is happening. And I created retrospective smells cards. And here they are. It's a deck of cards. You can print them out or you can use them electronically, whatever works for you. And the smell is described on one side of the card. The antidotes to the smell, let me show it like this, are described on the other side. So you would use the front side to recognize the smell and then the back side to look at the antidotes, to think of things that you can do to address it. Here's an example, blaming. So description of the smell, team members blame each other or the scrum master for things that have happened, are complaining or grumbling about the organization or management, whining about things they did themselves, or they show us versus them behavior. This is the kind of stuff that is not going to be beneficial for your retrospective. If something like this happened, you want to deal with that. The first step is to recognize this. That's why the term blaming in the short description, just an easy description that you can quickly recognize it. And if you want to address it, then there's the antidotes to work on this. Basically, these cards are training cards. You can use them in your retrospective, but they're more intended to retrain your retrospective facilitation skills to work on this and to help you to be prepared if this kind of stuff is happening in your retrospective. You can use them as a checklist card. That's why this short bulleted sentence in your retrospective, if you quickly want to grasp some ideas. But the main purpose of these cards is to really train your facilitation skills. The Agile Retrospective Smells cards are cards that you can use in your Agile Retrospective to improve your retrospective. So let me show you an example. This is a card which mentions recurring actions. So this is something that could happen in your retrospective. Same actions coming up over and over again. And on one side, the card explains the smell, explains what you might be seeing in your retrospective as a way to recognize it, to be aware of what's happening in there. On the other side, the card is proposing antidotes, proposing things that you can do as a retrospective facilitator to deal with this smell. So once you become aware of something like this is happening in your retrospective, it's giving you ideas. It's a kind of checklist card, so it's not something that you want to go through in detail in your retrospective. It's a reminder card that you can use in your retrospective to act on the situation if it's happening in there. So you better be prepared to use those cards and learn about this before you actually start using them in your retrospective. So, how would you use the Agile retrospective smartcards in your retrospective to facilitate your meeting to make sure that everything is going good in the retrospective meeting? Well, the way that I use them is that I would have them with me during the retrospective meeting, have them stacked, but have the titles visible. Let me show you how you can do this. I share my screen. So I would have the cards in front of me, and I would have the single word that describes the retrospective panel visible in there. Things like passiveness, lack of focus, energy lost. So that I'm continuously aware when I'm facilitating a meeting, I can do just a quick look on the cards that things are still going well. And if I smell any signal, if I smell that anything might be going wrong, I take a quick look at the cards to see, okay, do I recognize this? Is this one of the smells that's on the cards? And if that's the case, I can actually pick out the cards and go a little more detail. Remember, you're facilitating the retrospective, so you're leading the meeting. Everybody is looking at you to facilitate stuff that's ongoing in there. So you don't have much time to use these cards. That's why I made them as complex as possible, using the title and using the short description in there to be aware of the signals happening and to act quickly. So let's explore the cards in a little bit more detail. Let's see how we can actually use those cards during an HR retrospective or also for training purposes, because you can also use them over there in your retrospective. So for example, let's take the card on passiveness. And it's the title size and passiveness. People are not participating in the retrospectives. They do not contribute to discussions, appear to be away or disconnected, or are doing things not related to the retrospective during the meeting, like using their phone or talking to the person next to them. So somehow you lost those people in your retrospective. Somehow they're not connected anymore. What's happening in your, they're just being there, they're waiting until the retrospective is done to go back to their work. And this is not the situation that you would like to have in the retrospective. So when you start recognizing this kind of passiveness happening in your meeting as a retrospective facilitator, you want to act on that. And what you can do then is turn the card and look at the antidote for passiveness. What are the things that you can do as a retrospective facilitator if this kind of stuff is happening in your meeting? So there's an example here which says that make sure that at the start that you involve everybody, that you make it clear that you expect input from everyone. So this is a helpful reminder to set the scene for your retrospective and make sure that people are participating. Make sure that people feel comfortable, help them to explain themselves. So if you have the idea that somebody would like to contribute, but they don't know how to do it, they don't feel comfortable enough saying their ideas, sharing their meaning, help them to express themselves. As a facilitator, help them to formulate it. Make them feel safe enough to say stuff during the meeting and involve them into the meeting. Use exercises. This is something that you can do in your preparation already, but also during the meeting. Make sure that people are actually doing something to keep them involved into the retrospective. So these are the kind of things that you can do to prevent passiveness from happening in your retrospective, or to act upon this if passiveness is happening. Again, these are cards that you can use to prepare yourself for the retrospective. So you would use these cards up front to see how to arrange a retrospective, what kind of exercise you want to do, how you will make sure that people are involved in there if you want to prevent something like passiveness happening in there. But you can also use them during the meeting if something like this happens to make sure that you can connect upon this. Let's explore now how we can use these cards to train our skills, to develop our skills as retrospective facilitators. And I use these cards a lot in the workshops that I do at conferences, workshops on site with customers. What I do in these workshops is to hand out the cards to the people sitting together at the table and ask them to take a look at the smells which are there and to mention if they had any of these smells in their retrospective. If they see this kind of stuff happening in their retrospective. And if they do, I ask them to share a story, to tell them what happened in the retrospective. How did you recognize it? How did it impact your retrospective? What was happening in there? And once we go into the story and once the people at the table will see the impact, then the next question would be, okay, how did you deal with it? Or how can we deal with this kind of stuff? What can we do to prevent this kind of smells happening in a retrospective, prevent this kind of anti-patterns happening in there? And usually a lot of good ideas pop up already, because these are people who have been facilitating retrospectives before, so they have some ideas on how to do this. Next, we turn the cards and we go to the antidotes. We look at the antidotes and they will probably recognize some stuff in there, but usually there's also stuff that they didn't think about. And there might be some things in there on the antidotes list that they would like to practice. And then we can actually do a role play and say, okay, let's climb into this role, let's make this smell happen in this retrospective right now, in this safe setting, to try it out. And let's see how you as a facilitator can deal with this to get the problem out of the way, to get this empty pattern out of the way, and get your retrospective back on track. So these cards, simple cards, but very powerful, can be a great aid to develop your retrospective facilitating skills. You can download the retrospective smells cards from my website for a nominal fee. When you download them, you will get PDF files so that you can print them out and create physical cards. And then, for instance, you can plastify them to make them more durable. But you can also decide to use the cardboard in between, make them into something like a real card in there, make them double-sided, depending on what works best for you. So download the files, print them out, and create the cards, and then you can use them in your retrospectives, and you can also use them to train your retrospective skills. You also get JPEG files, so you can also use these cards, images of the cards, when you're doing online retrospectives, or if you want to share them with other people in your team and discuss retrospective smells and improve your skills for dealing with them. So you can also use them in remote meetings, so to facilitate both online retrospectives, but also remote distributed retrospectives. The quality of your retrospectives is really depending on the way that your retrospective meeting is being facilitated. It depends on the facilitation skills of the person leading that meeting. Facilitation is really a key aspect of your retrospective. And starting to recognize this, that facilitation is so important, is already a first step. And I've seen a lot of teams who weren't aware of this. They were scheduling all the meetings. They adopted Scrum as a way of working in the organization. And they also scheduled their retrospectives. They looked into the Scrum guide and says like, okay, the Scrum Master has to facilitate this meeting. Okay, Scrum Master facilitate the meeting, planned it. Start asking the question, see what happens in there, and work with the people to get something out of that. That is not facilitation. It might be leading the meeting, but even that's questionable. Facilitation starts with having really somebody who's focusing on the outcome of the meeting, of the result of the meeting, on the process that is followed in this meeting, the atmosphere in the meeting. That is what a facilitator is concerned about, to get the best result out of people. And we're going to explore also what best result means and how the role of facilitator fits in there. But let's first start with the prime directive. And the prime directive is a statement that was made by Norm Kurt in his book Project Retrospectives. But this is something that's really true to all kinds of retrospectives, not just project. Also for agile teams, also multi-team retrospectives. And the prime directive basically says is that we have to start from the assumption that everybody did the best thing they could, and whatever happened is something that could have happened. People did the best they could, given the situation, given the knowledge that they had at that point in time, given the information that they had, the skills that they possessed. Looking back right now, We hope to find ways to improve this. But we should refrain from blaming, we should refrain from complaining or pointing to people, because that's not going to be helpful. Let's start from the assumption that the best thing that could happen has happened, that people did the best they can do. And this is a very basic statement. It's the same as people come to work to do a good job. People don't come to work to fuck up. They come to work to do a good job. And let's start from this assumption in our retrospective and then try to learn from this. I think it's important that whoever is facilitating the meeting is independent, so refrains from sending the team, pushing the team into a certain direction. That this person is not making any decisions in the retrospective meeting about what these kind of decisions are up to the team members. It's their retrospective, it's their meeting to reflect, it's their meeting to learn, and it's up to them to decide where they want to go. And this can be challenging if the Scrum Master is facilitating the retrospective, because the Scrum Master might have some ideas on what he or she thinks will be the best thing for the team. And I often say that the team is always right, even if they are wrong. So if the team wants to improve something, and this is a different thing than something that the Scrum Master thinks should be improved, or something that the team should be working on according to the Scrum Master, then I think as a Scrum Master, it's best to go with the team, to use the energy to do the thing that the team thinks is right for them. Often they were actually right. Often they picked the thing that really helped them. This is joint knowledge. This is people from the team who looked at this problem from different perspectives and then decide where they want to work on. The other thing is that if you want something to happen where people are not really feeling the energy, where they're not really motivated to do it, chances of succeeding are going to be much less. And even in some of the cases where the team is working at the wrong thing, when it turns out after a couple of sprints that that wasn't helpful, the best way to find out is for the team to learn themselves, not for the Scrum Master or anybody else to tell them. So try to remain independent. I think that's a really important issue in there. If there's something going wrong in your retrospective, if it's failing, if somebody is blaming, whatever negative thing is happening in there, the facilitator should deal with that immediately. Don't let this slumber, don't let this further hurt your retrospective. Bring it up, act on it, get it out of the way. And sometimes those negative issues are that big that they actually become the main topic of your retrospective. This is also a reason why I like the one word retrospective exercise so much, because if it brings up a negative issue, if it brings up a really big problem where people don't feel comfortable on the team, then that is the one thing to work on. It can be a starting exercise, it can be a warming up exercise for your retrospective, but if a main issue comes up, focus on that one. Make sure you solve that one before you continue. As a retrospective facilitator, you want to make sure that everybody participates. So if somebody is being silent during the retrospective, ask them to contribute, ask them to speak up, ask them, and maybe you need to stop somebody else from speaking for just a moment, like, okay, hold on, I would also like to hear what he or she is thinking about this. So can you wait just a moment to see what other people are thinking about this? Give space to people, give space to everyone. By the way, giving space also means that you're not taking up much space yourself. As a facilitator, you're giving space to everybody in there. And I do this in retrospectives, for instance, by asking people to do stuff, asking them to contribute, asking them to say how they feel about stuff, up to even asking them to go over to the whiteboard, put down their sticky notes, asking them to cluster sticky notes in there to see how they go together, asking them to come up with a name. There's a lot of stuff in there that you don't need to do as a facilitator, but that you can actually ask people to do, or just wait and see what happens in there. Sometimes the best thing you can do as a retrospective facilitator is just to be silent and see what happens in there. If you're talking most of the time, Something is wrong with your retrospective. It shouldn't be your show. It's the show for the team. It's for them to learn. As a facilitator, you want to be focusing also on the process. And you're bringing the team to different stages in your retrospective. You want them to feel safe at first. That's also why you use the prime directive. You want them to speak up or to bring in ideas, to bring in problems, whatever that you're exploring in your retrospective. And you're going to be diverting initially. You're going to be wider and wider, bringing up more topics, bringing up more ideas. And that's okay, because you want to get an overview. You want to get the whole picture in there of the topic that you're working on. But at some point in time, you want to convert it back to a couple of issues, a couple of actions, and get to a decision point of what you want to do with this. And as a retrospective facilitator, you're helping the team to go through these different stages, get to a decision point, and get to actions coming out of this retrospective. You'll also be doing timekeeping on this, so you're going to be monitoring how the time is going, how much of time you're spending on stuff. But this is something that I prefer to do together with the team. So I can check with the team and ask them if they need more time to come up with ideas. I can ask them if there's something that's worth discussing or not. Should we spend time on this? Or should we stop this right now? So this is something that you do in collaboration with the team, but it's primarily the facilitator who is doing the timekeeping, seeing how things are going in there. And I think as a respective facilitator, listen, and listen actively. Ask questions, help people to phrase themselves, let people to rephrase if they say something, perhaps in a way that they're blaming people, but listen on what's happening in there. And by listening, you're also setting an example. You're making it clear to the whole team in the retrospective that it's important to listen. One person talking, other persons are listening, trying to understand this, asking questions, trying to get a good view of what's happening in there. So being that example as a retrospective facilitator is very important. These are just some tips, some ideas, some suggestions on what you can do to improve your retrospective facilitation skills. There's much more in there. And there's workshops that I also do to improve your facilitation skills. And my main suggestion is to people facilitating retrospectives, start working on this. And maybe it can help you to have somebody in your retrospective who's giving you feedback after the retrospective on how you facilitate the meeting. You can ask it to the team, but you can also have somebody in there just to watch how the retrospective is going and give you feedback to become a better retrospective facilitator. Okay, our last retrospective debugging technique for today is about how you can assess the strengths and weaknesses of your retrospectives. And this is about self-assessing. This is not about auditing your retrospective. This is about getting an insight together with your team on how your retrospectives are doing and acting upon that. And one of the techniques that you can use to do this is a technique which comes from my book, The Agile Self-Assessment Game, and from The Agile Self-Assessment Game. And this is a technique where you use a health check. You do a health check with a radar chart to see how your retrospectives are going. So please watch this demonstration, how you can do this, again, on-site or remotely with your teams. An Agile self-assessment is a tool to dive into how things are going in your team, in your organization. It's a technique that you can use to reflect on how the work is being done, how people are working together, and to find out how you can improve this, how you can get better results, improve the way that you are working together in a team and in your organization. I've created the Agile Self-Assessment Game. And the Agile Self-Assessment Game is a gamification. It's a technique where people work together to explore and to learn. And it's a great way to reflect on the way of working, the way of working in your team, and to find ways to improve. The gamification consists of cards that have text about things that you can do, things that you will be doing probably when you're working together as a team, and playing formats that you can use with these cards to find ways to improve, to learn about how things are going in your organization. And this is a very safe way to learn and improve. And is it something you can do yourself as a team? You can have a coach to guide you, but you don't really need one. You can play this game yourself. You can discuss how things are going. Think about what you would like to improve. And that's the big difference with this kind of gamification. You're in control. You can decide what you want to do, what you don't want to do. It's your improvement. It's your agile journey that you're working on. Nothing will be imposed on you. That makes this a great tool for improvement. So let's explore how we can use the Agile self-assessment game and cards from this game to improve our Agile retrospectives. Let me share my screen for that. So here are 8 cards that I took from the Agile self-assessment game. These cards are all about Agile retrospectives. The one mentioned here, Agile retrospectives are done frequently. The one below there, actions from the retrospectives are done to improve continuously. So these are cards taken from the deck of cards that come with the Agile self-assessment game. And this game format, the radar chart, is described in this book, the Agile self-assessment game. And you would actually work together as a team to reflect on how your retrospectives are going. So you would ask everybody to rate on a scale from 0 to 5 how they think they will be doing currently. And they could use these symbols to do it. So let's say that I'm blue, and I would say, well, we're doing it frequently, but sometimes we're skipping them. So let's give a 3 for that. And all team members, including testers and the product owners, participate. Well, our product owner isn't there. So it's a 2. And the team reflects on the way of working using observed behavior data. There's some data in there, but well, I think we might do better on that. Actions. Well, we're very strict on following up, so we're actually doing great on that. So I would actually rate it as a 4. And all team members can do this, and they may have different opinions in there. So somebody might say, well, are we doing pretty well? No, we're skipping them too much. Where somebody else might say, well, I think we're overdoing it. And as we're doing it right now, it's good. And actually, if something like this pops up where people have different opinions in there, that would be interesting to have a discussion and to see, okay, why these differences? And think about how the current practice is. Do you want to keep it like that? Is there something in there that you would like to improve to agree upon your way of working? So it's actually good that these kind of differences will pop up during this exercise to discuss it and to see how you can improve your Agile retrospectives. So we have seen how we can use the Agile self-assessment game to reflect on how we are doing, as the title of the game says, self-assess our performance and decide where we want to go, where we want to travel our Agile journey in there. Find more information about this game at www.benlinders.com/game, where you can find the game, where you can find the cards, the book, everything that goes with this game. You can not only use this for retrospective, this can be used for lots of situations. You can actually also use it in your retrospective to reflect how things are going and find ways to improve in that. Wish you much fun, much playing fun with the Agile retrospectives and with the Agile self-assessment game. There's things that you can do in your retrospectives to make them successful. Why over how? Focus on the result of your retrospective. Focus on the topic that you would like to improve, the topic that the team finds most important. And why over how also means that as a facilitator, you should be flexible on how you are facilitating the meeting. If you find out during the retrospective that an exercise you are doing doesn't resonate with the people and are looking for something differently, change it, adopt it, accommodate, do whatever that would help the people to bring out the right stuff and deal with it. And don't stick to, okay, I plan to do this exercise, so I'm going to do this exercise right now. This is Agile. We don't want to be planned if we want to adopt a change in there. Develop your facilitation skills, as I mentioned already. Practice them in a safe situation. Help people to give you feedback on your retrospective skills. Close your retrospective to get some feedback. I usually close my retrospective by asking the team, like, okay, was this a good meeting? What do you think about how we did this? What do you think about the actions that came out of this? To get some quick feedback from the people who were there in the retrospective. If there's something that they weren't happy about it, they will say it, and I can pick it up and I can work on that to improve my retrospective. If they are happy about it, that increases the chance that they won't do another retrospective, because they say, yeah, we had a good meeting, we got some good actions out of this, great, let's do one again 2 weeks from now, cool. So this is important in there. Think about the exercises that you want to use in your retrospective. And again, there's a full list on my website. There's also a list of resources in there to more retrospective exercises in there. Practice those different exercises. Maybe practice them in a safe session. Or try them out and tell the team that you are trying it out. Like, this is the first time that I do this exercise. There might be something going wrong, so please bear with me, but I think this is an exercise that will help us to find good improvements that will help us do them. Make it small, frequent small steps for improvement, because the whole idea with retrospectives, with these reflection sessions and doing actions, is that you want to get into a cycle of continuous improvement. And you want to develop your skills to do this kind of continuous improvement. So it's more important to take small steps and to focus on the vital few actions. Don't have too many actions in your retrospective, because you're going to not be able to do them anyway. Just make sure that you have the vital few actions, the most important stuff that you want to do in your retrospective right now. That's going to help your team to improve. And that's going to be next retrospective, where you can do additional actions. So this sums up the virtual workshop on retrospecting your retrospectives for Experience Agile. We're going to have a Q&A session right now, 30 minutes, to really dive into the questions that you have. And I'm really looking forward to this, to hear the issues that you are facing there and to see how we can solve them. If you want to reach out to me, here's my contact information, or feel free to send me an email to contact me on Twitter, or connect with me on LinkedIn, visit my website or whatever. Happy to help you with that. But without further ado, let's go to the Q&A right now. So come up with your questions on retrospecting your retrospectives. Okay, welcome everybody. Hope that you enjoyed the workshop recording that I did and the exercises that I did in there to show how you can debug your HR retrospect, how you can find ways to improve in there. So we have time for questions right now. Is there anything that you would like to ask, anything you would like to share? Let's speak up. Let's start this going.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Hi, my name is Maria. And one of my questions and one of the things that I struggle the most is how to draw retroactions. Because in the end, as a facilitator, I'm a Scrum Master, and as a facilitator, I always feel like I should be the one assigning the actions to me, or trying to solve a certain problem, or trying to come up with a solution. So it's really hard to make sure that a team gets the initiative and starts talking.
Is this about the team starts talking about the problems, the issues that they are facing, or if they start talking about the actions that they would like to do?
Well, they do talk about the problem. So until the part of getting them to talk and coming up with the problems, that's fine. It's more about, well, a retrospective should have retroactions, right? Just so we can put in practice the things, or so we can improve the process or any problem that's coming. And my problem and the biggest difficulty that I have is how to draw effective retroactions.
Mm-hmm. Okay, you are the Scrum Master. Are you also the facilitator of the retrospective?
Normally, yeah.
Okay, that might be a first challenge already, because if you are the facilitator, you are sharing the meeting, but since you're also the Scrum Master, you're not independent. That's one of the things I mentioned in my workshop in there. Preferably, you want to have an independent facilitator in there who can actually make the connection between the team members and the Scrum Master when it comes to taking action there. Somebody who also can facilitate the discussion on, okay, if we have this problem, what kind of action can we do and who should take action? Is this something that we really need a Scrum Master to take action, or would this be something that the team can do, or maybe one or two team members from the team can do? So the challenge might already be in you being there in a double role as a Scrum Master and as a facilitator. And as a facilitator, they expect you to come to actions out of the meeting. And as a Scrum Master, might even expect you to take those actions. And then they're going to lean back and going to relax and see what's happening in there. Like, okay, you're the Scrum Master. You should solve all of our problems. So maybe one idea would be to have somebody else in there to facilitate the discussion and to work together with the team to see, okay, what's the kind of stuff that, okay, this is really something the Scrum Master should do, and this is something that actually team members can do. And I actually have a game which I play in some of my works in there, which is on handling impediments. And it's around the same question. Who should be solving this impediment that the team is facing right now? Is it the Scrum Master? Is it the team? And when we play the game, we actually find out with teams that for, let's say, 8 out of 10, maybe even 9 out of 10 problems, the team members can solve it themselves without the Scrum Master. But by playing the game, by discussing what's happening in there, by discussing what needs to be done, they find out, yeah, we can do that. We don't need Scrum Master to solve our problems. And that actually promotes self-organization within the team. So instead of having the team relying on the Scrum Master solving all problems, the whole team is becoming self-organized and much more empowered. So that will be the challenge. So my first suggestion would be, could you have somebody else facilitating it and focusing on getting these kind of discussions on what can I do and what should the Scrum Master do? Is this helpful?
Yeah, thank you. It is helpful.
Okay, great.
I just have to find someone that can facilitate.
What often works is if you have another Scrum Master in your company, you have multiple teams, ask another Scrum Master to step in, because they are familiar with retrospective. They know how to facilitate them. And you can even cross-facilitate. You could facilitate retrospective on another team, and someone from our team could do your retrospective. Just share the meeting in there. And it doesn't take much time, and you're actually learning from each other when you're doing this. So it's also a great learning opportunity.
Thank you.
Okay. More questions, please.
Hi, Ben. Can you hear me? Great. Thank you for your talk. I took a lot of great stuff out of it and some inspiration that I'll definitely take back into our team.
Cool.
I had one question just about kind of calling out these anti-patterns in retrospectives. So as a facilitator, sometimes it's quite difficult if you're trying to encourage everyone to be open and to contribute, and people are coming up with maybe this kind of us versus them phraseology, and kind of other anti-patterns are coming up, and you want to kind of call them out and steer them away from doing that. Do you have any tips of how, as a facilitator, you can do that without really shutting someone down? Because I don't want them to feel like their point is invalid. It's just about phrasing it in a different way, right? And trying to be more collaborative. And that's something that I find really tricky.
Yeah. Well, actually, the thing you mentioned already is one technique to do that is to simply ask them to rephrase something. So when somebody pulls out a problem, but is actually telling it in a way that he's pointing the finger to somebody in a team, or blaming people in a team, or blaming what's happening there, simply ask them to rephrase, like, can you rephrase the problem without pointing it to the people? We want to learn about the problem. It's not about putting blame on somebody. So can we rephrase it in a way that we can better understand what this problem is about? You can start asking questions as a facilitator to go deeper in there. And then your question would be, okay, what was causing the situation? What was the contact that caused this to happen in there? This also goes back to the prime directive that I mentioned in there. You're starting on the assumption that the team did the best they could do, given on what they knew at that time, given the context that they had. So again, repeating that that is the assumption that you want to work on with the team in your retrospective. Okay, how can we learn as much as possible about this problem that has happened to me? How can we really understand this? Start drawing it. Visualizing your problem often can help a lot. Causal analysis, doing a cause chart, anything else that helps you to explore it and to bring anything that's being discussed out of there on, even if it's a whiteboard, online whiteboard screen, or if you're in a physical room on a physical whiteboard, making visible on what is coming up makes it also easy for people to add stuff in there to complete the picture and to come to a shared picture to get a better understanding. So that would be the kind of techniques you can bring out in there to help people to bring up stuff. If it's really about people being scared to pick up, it's always a challenge. It really depends a lot on the situation that you have in the room in there. Sometimes you can just mention that people are being silent and that will do it already. You can do a safety check at the start and ask people to just rate how safe they feel on a scale from 1 to 5. And then give it back to the room like, okay, we have so many 5, 4, 3, 2, 1s in the room without telling who scored what, because that's not important. It's what's there in the room that makes it important. And giving the scores back can be enough already, what I've seen with teams, because people who feel safe in a retrospective usually don't expect other people don't feel safe. Because I think, yeah, I feel safe, I can speak up, so why would anybody not feel safe in the meeting? Making them aware that there's a couple of people in there that are not feel safe and raising the issue, okay, what can we do to increase safety? What could be the thing that's blocking people or making them feel unsafe? Bringing it up as a topic of a discussion. And by the way, if you have a lot of ones to do, then that's the topic of your retrospective. Start working on that. Because that's the main issue that you have in the team right now. If people don't feel safe, work on that before anything else, because that's going to help you to do any other thing you want to do in there. Okay, I saw you taking some notes, and I'm hoping you capture some of the stuff in here. I also published the slides already, so I can share the link also in the chat so that people can access it for more ideas. These are the kind of stuff I can think of.
Great, thanks a lot. Really helpful.
Okay, you're welcome. So, more questions? Anybody wants to bring up a main problem that they're having in their retrospective right now? What's the main challenge that you have?
I have one question. You said it is a good idea to separate the role of the facilitator and the Scrum Master. And mm-hmm. I'm a developer, I'm not a Scrum Master. And we are trying to kind of assign this role to different people every meeting we have. That being daily or retro or demonstration meetings. But we actually don't use the word facilitator. So I think we do it without knowing that we have to have this facilitator skills. So how can we kind of train the team members to be that facilitator to withdraw itself from the role they play in the team and be that facilitator?
Well, I think the first thing you mentioned already, and by the way, this is great that you are rotating that role. The first thing is to be aware that people then have a double role in the meeting. They're participating and they are the facilitator. They are running the meeting. They are setting the scene. They're the key person on making what's happening in there in the room. So the first recognition already is to have this role. And then the second thing would be to see how you can further improve this role in there. And I think the key thing in there, what I've seen, is feedback. And I actually do it myself when I'm facilitating the retrospective. I usually just take a couple of minutes at the end of the retrospective just to check with the team on how this meeting went. And if they have any feedback from me as a facilitator on how they can improve. If they're happy with the way that this meeting has gone, if they're happy with the actions that came out of this meeting, which is also kind of sanity check on, is this good stuff? Is this useful? So asking for this feedback could be a way already. If you're really looking at training these facilitation skills, you could also agree with the person who's facilitating the meeting, who's taking the role of running a meeting, that you will have a double role in the meeting too, participating, but also looking at the facilitator and giving feedback afterwards, outside the meeting. So that could be a way to do it. And this is actually where the smells card that I mentioned could be helpful in there, because they're listing smells in one way, like things that can happen in your retrospective, things that you would like to see in there, but we're also giving ideas on how to deal with that kind of situation in there, the antidotes that I mentioned on the backside of the class. So these kind of antidotes could be something that you could actually check, like, okay, how's the facilitator dealing with this situation when this happens? And you could use them to give ideas like, okay, this might be something that you want to try out in your next retrospective, practice it. If you want to go one step further, then the bingo could be a great one if you really go into the role playing, because then for sure you're going to get this kind of behavior. Then you're really challenging your retrospective deal with them. Then that would not be a normal retrospective. That would actually become more or less a training session for your facilitation skills. So it depends how much you want to invest in that. I would suggest to start slowly and get that feedback cycle, because if you can get that going, that's already going to give you a lot of improvement in there. That's already going to give you a lot of benefits as the teams. And once people start getting good in doing this kind of observation and feedback, that's also going to help you as a general skill to improve along the way.
Okay, thank you.
Welcome. Okay, we have time for more questions. So anybody wants to talk about the biggest challenge that they have right now in their retrospectives?
I have one further question, if no one else is ready to ask. Our team is fully distributed, fully remote team, and we still struggle sometimes with like different games or ways to really connect with each other over that distance. So I'm wondering if during the pandemic, especially, you've seen anyone using any particular types of games or other ways of like spicing up their retrospectives that might be useful for all of us.
I see a lot of people trying out stuff with games, and the big challenge indeed is doing them remotely. I face the same challenge doing most retrospective and also most retrospective training on site, where you can work with physical games, where you can work with physical cards in there. And there's more and more online tools becoming available where you can actually play around with these kind of games. And I've been using Jamboard for some of the sessions in there with cards. The biggest challenge with Jamboard is you can't really do any zooming in there. So you can't really zoom out or zoom in on top. So it's pretty limited on what you can do. The big challenge is the big advantage gives you one overview screen where all the stuff is there. I've been using Concept Board, where you actually can do the zooming and panning and really zoom into situations and also play with multiple boards and do kind of card games in there. I've actually done situations in training sessions where I use multiple boards and bringing in cards from one board into a gaming setting to actually simulate, like, okay, this is a problem that's happening right now. How shall we deal with that? It's also an easy to use tool. It can get slow if you're using a lot of cards in there. That's a challenge, and you want limited in there. And other tools like Miro, you can do a lot of stuff with that. Lino is a great tool online with virtual perspective. There's actually a list of tools, not only whiteboard, but also specific retrospective tools. That's on my website, on the toolbox for retrospective exercise in there. It's also a way of becoming comfortable with that as a facilitator on trying it out and see how it works out in there, because none of these tools really work the same way as you could work online. Sometimes the best thing to do is just to play the game at one person, have them as a kind of facilitator of the game, and use double cameras. So use a camera for everybody and put the second camera on the physical game and play the game physically and say, okay, I will have the board in front of me, I will have the cards, but we're playing it together. So whatever happens in the team, I will adjust the board or the cards or pick any card, and play the game for everybody. Act as a kind of physical facilitator in there. And if you have a camera on that board, then people can see what's happening in there. And you can do the same by screen sharing with a whiteboard, but the physical board just provides you with a couple of more possibilities, like turning cards and that kind of stuff. So it's this experimenting. The thing I've also learned from this is try to keep it as simple as possible. You might want to do multiple things in there and think about multiple stacks of cards and all kind of stuff. And think of that and then think, okay, how can I make it easier? And that will reduce the risk of things going wrong during the game, your game failing in some way then. Because if it's going to fail too much, then you're going to lose the attention from people in there. So try to make it as simple, as easy as possible. The main thing, benefits I've seen with gamification, that's the thing that you want to get going in there, so people participate, get into this gamification spirit, start talking about stuff, start sharing the issues that they have, the problems that they have, start looking for solutions together, start collaborating. And it turns out that you don't need much stuff to get that kind of things going. So usually you just want to do too much, and if you reduce it to something easier, you're going to get the same result already.
Cool, thanks. Yeah, one thing we do is just try and, when we're trying out new tools, we just treat everything as an experiment. And if it doesn't work out, then hey, we just move on to the next thing. And that's kind of a fun way as well. Even if something goes wrong, sometimes it kind of pulls the team together because you can all laugh at something going wrong.
Exactly. So. Yeah. Cool. You say like, okay, so this failed, so we learned that's not something that we don't want to do again. Yeah. And that's okay. Okay. Any other questions? I think we still have some time left.
I can ask one more because I have one. It's something that I saw coming up a couple of times actually, and I've been thinking about this as well, but I didn't have really like a clear answer, which is, are there any kind of retrospective templates we could use when our team is really on a winning streak and doing really well? Because, you know, often the retrospective focuses on how to improve or things that went wrong. And when your team is on a winning streak, it's really nice to use the retrospective to kind of celebrate that and think about how you can replicate that success in the future. So I wonder if you have any kind of retrospective templates or formats that are good when a team are on that kind of winning streak.
Yeah, well, there's a couple that come to mind. One would be what's called the perfection game. And this comes from the core protocols. And the perfection game is actually a kind of exercise which is based on what was often called positive psychology. So it's looking at strengths that the teams have, things that are going well, and looking on how to improve them further. And then you're asking team member actually to rate a certain practice or rate a certain way of working on a scale from 1 to 10. But you also have to explain why you're giving this rating in there. So if you're rating something on, say, we're doing an 8 or 9, then you should say why it's an 8 or 9. What's the good things are happening there? What's the strengths that the team already has to make this going? And then the next question would be, okay, what if you would like to make this perfect? What if you want to go for 10? What can we do to improve it one step further, to go even further in making this even a stronger practice in there? Another exercise would be also looking at core qualities, like, okay, there were some problems that the team managed to solve in the sprint, for instance. What is it that made it possible? What is the strengths, what are the skills that this team possesses that made it possible to solve this problem? What is the things that the team did? How did they react to the situation that enabled them to do it? And once you've got a clear overview, and again, visualization will be a great aid in here. So write it down, put it on sticky notes, or visualize in any way that you want to do it. Once you've got this list of strength that this team possesses, you could say, okay, is there any main challenge that the team is facing right now? And how could we use these strengths that we have as a team to solve that problem? How could we work with that? And I had a retrospective one time where I actually used the question that Norm Kurtz came up with, which is, what surprised you? And what puzzles you? What is the thing that you don't have a clear insight in there? And when I asked the question to the team in their retrospective, what puzzles you, they mentioned like, no, what puzzles us is that we actually managed to finish this project on time. And we started 6 months ago. And when we started this, everybody said, we're not going to be able to finish this project on time. We're going to be late for sure. There's much too much stuff in there that needs to happen. We're never going to get this done. And they spent the first 3-4 weeks actually debating with their project manager, with everybody involved to get more time. They couldn't get it. Then they started working and they actually managed to finish on time. And I started asking them like, okay, what was it that made the difference? What was it that happened in this project that enabled you to deliver on time and to finish the project successfully? And facilitating that discussion, we came up with a lot of good stuff that they did in the team. And by the time that we did this, the project team was dismantled and they were in new projects already, different projects, but they actually managed to pull out some of the stuff what was happening in that team when they were together in that project as strengths that they could use in the team that they were in right now. So it's recognizing the good stuff is in there and using that as a kind of lever to improve whatever you would like to improve in there. Okay. More questions? Anybody? Okay, switching to the facilitators right now, this workshop, Home Experience Agile. Is there any closing remarks or any question from your side on this mini workshop?
Just thank you for sharing all your insights.
You're welcome. Okay, if there's no more questions, then I think we can close the sessions. I've already published the slides. Let me share that on the chat. So the slides of today's session are available online. These slides also include a lot of links on the stuff that I talked about, be it the different games in there, be it the different kind of exercise you can do, the facilitation tips, all the other stuff that I talked about. So if you want to get more information, want to go deeper on something, use those slides. If you have more questions, also feel free to connect with me on Twitter, on LinkedIn, email, whatever works for you, and happy to help you out with it. If there's something that you want to share, something that you want to learn more about. So thank you for being in my mini workshop now. I hope you enjoyed it. I hope you pulled out some learning out there. And my final suggestion would be, if there's anything there, I think it's already mentioned, just try it out. Start experimenting with this. Use this stuff in your next retrospective and see how that works out. See how things are going in there.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.